Hello, my name is Prabhu Rambhadran. I'm a senior product marketing manager in the Windows Server and System Center product management team. Today we're going to talk about what's new in the world of networking with Windows Server 2012 R2. In the previous video, we specifically focused on software-defined networking and what kind of software-defined networking solution Microsoft offers with Windows Server 2012 R2 and System Center 2012 R2. In this part, we'll get into more details outside the SDN space. We're going to learn what we've done in terms of improving performance, in terms of improving resiliency and reliability, in terms of simplifying management, and what we've done in terms of mapping or managing, in terms of seamlessly connecting private clouds with public cloud or service providers cloud. So let's get into the details now. So we briefly spoke about this in the previous video where, you know, network resiliency is becoming more and more important for two reasons, right? One, the VM traffic, the VM to VM traffic across multiple hosts relies on the underlying network, right? On the NIC that basically connects the VM to the outside world. The other important thing is as 10 gig NICs become more and more popular and as 40 gig NICs are again making its entry into data centers, customers are utilizing network as an infrastructure, as a shared infrastructure to talk to their storage, talk to other hosts, and talk to the outside world. What this means is that downtime is no longer accepted. So all the intelligence needs to be built into the product so that the product is continuously, or the apps are continuously available. And Windows Server 2012 and enhancements in R2 provides a great resilient infrastructure for networking per se. So the goal is to run services without any interruption. That's an obvious these days, right? I mean, think of watching a video on YouTube. Even a 3-second buffer is not acceptable these days. So someone might accidentally pull a network cable in. And that should not essentially result in someone not getting access to the files they want or a video that they're watching and so on. We want to automatically fix failures as and when it happens, right? If you go walk into the Azure data center or data centers in Facebook, the data centers are designed so that it can continue to work without any interruptions all the way up to 25% hardware failures. So the first time when someone would actually get into the data center and replace parts is when, you know, it's actually crossed the 25% threshold. So there needs to be a lot of automation that is built in and resiliency that's built in that remediates the problem automatically and the lights are up all the time. And we wanted to give the ability, I mean, if you think of shared infrastructure, right? Let's say that you have a 10 gig NIC that's shared by multiple VMs that run on top of it or that run in the host. We want to make sure that, you know, we give consistent bandwidth or predictable bandwidth to all the VMs that sit on top. And finally, we wanted to kind of embrace a multi-vendor ecosystem, right? No matter what NICs you have, the experience to a large extent remains the same. The features that basically light up that we have in Windows Server 2012 and enhanced in R2 that light up these functionalities are quality of service, NIC teaming, DHCP failover, and SMB multi-channel. Let's learn more about each of these features now. SMB multi-channel, this is primarily focused on, you know, storage to a large extent. Think of an SMB client and an SMB server, right? So the client could be your Hyper-V node. And VMs running on it, and your SMB server could actually be a scale-out file server that exposes storage or that basically exposes data that lives in the storage underneath. With SMB multi-channel, what we are essentially doing is the packets from the client onto the server are automatically distributed across multiple NICs if they exist and multiple traffic paths that exist between the client and server. So without the need to configure anything at all, Windows Server automatically recognizes all the available paths and sends packet through all the paths. So this gives additional performance and it gives additional resiliency so that even if one path fails, let's say that someone accidentally pulls a cable out, Windows Server automatically recognizes it and then resends the packet again through a different path. So think of this as a major enhancement to multipath I/O that exists today. So this is Windows' version of multipath I/O where data is flushed across all the possible paths. Again, there's no configuration that needs to be done here. As long as you have Windows Server 2012 and above and Windows 8, for example, on the client side and above, things should just work. But if you don't want it, you could obviously configure it using PowerShell, turn it off or turn it on. In terms of DHCP servers and high availability, there aren't a whole lot of things that we've done with R2. But what's interesting is that, you know, a lot of people still don't know this. The DHCP service is highly available. In the past, if you want the DHCP server to be highly available, you needed to cluster them together. But with Windows Server 2012, you could essentially have an active passive DHCP server without the need for clustering. So you could do two things here. You could either configure it for hot standby, where if a primary DHCP server goes down, the secondary DHCP server automatically takes over, or you could make it a load sharing mode where the load is shared between two DHCP servers. Again, this was introduced in 2012, but it's good to know. Again, the provisioning is super simple. You could use PowerShell to provision it, PowerShell to configure it, but a good feature there. Quality of service, again, something that we introduced in 2008, right, where you have the ability to set maximum QoS, saying that every VM can have up to X amount of Mbps or X amount of network bandwidth that they could use. With Windows Server 2012, we've introduced both minimum QoS and maximum QoS. So what this does is that it provides a ceiling. QoS, again, is quality of service. It provides a ceiling which says that this is the bandwidth, this is the maximum amount of bandwidth that a given VM or an app that's running in a given VM can take. And this is the minimum bandwidth that the app needs. For example, you might have a SQL VM that's running on a shared infrastructure for which you want to guarantee 50% of the bandwidth that's available, right? So you could essentially give a minimum bandwidth of 50% of whatever NIC that you have underneath, and the host would automatically make sure that this specific VM gets at least that amount of bandwidth. Again, you could do it from within the VM properties or use PowerShell from within the VM to configure it. NIC teaming, this was introduced in 2012 again. So this, again, provides resiliency with respect to NIC failures, right? NIC teaming is not uncommon, right? A lot of customers do NIC teaming today. But the catch there is that if you have a NIC teaming solution from vendor A, all the NICs that are teamed together should be from that specific vendor. So NIC teaming basically accumulates a bunch of NICs together and provides a single team for the VMs above to use it, so that even if one NIC fails, the other NIC is available and the data is continuously flowing. So you have high availability. But the catch before 2012 was that a team could only have NICs from a specific vendor. Windows Server 2012 provided a NIC teaming inbox. So you could essentially have up to 32 network adapters being part of a NIC. And these NICs could be from a variety of vendors. You had multiple modes, switch independent and switch dependent, where the switch actually knows that the team exists or a team doesn't exist. And you could configure it using the UI through the server manager UI or using PowerShell. So both were supported. Again, this was introduced in Windows Server 2012. But the challenge with 2012 was that if you have a NIC, right, if you have a NIC team and data is flowing through the team and Windows determined that a specific set of packets need to flow through a given given physical NIC, it doesn't dynamically adjust depending on the traffic that flows through other NICs. For example, if a VM is sending out, if you're hosting a large file server, right, and there's constant access to data from that file server, you're doing a large copy, for example, the data is always sent through the through a given NIC within a particular team, and it isn't dynamically load balanced depending on the traffic across multiple traffic in multiple NICs within the same team. So in 2012 R2, we've introduced this concept called dynamic NIC teaming, where you know we have this concept called flows and flowlets, right? So we basically determine natural breaks in packet flow, and between these breaks, we dynamically split the packet flow across multiple NICs. So essentially what you're doing is a flow goes to a specific NIC, we determine a gap, and then the next flow is automatically rebalanced to a NIC that's free. So this effectively makes use of all the NICs that you have in the team depending on what your need is. The next topic is around performance, what we've done in terms of networking to enhance performance. Again, it goes back to the 10 gig analogy that I gave, where you're using your NIC, your traditional network infrastructure for storage as well. So getting the most or the maximum performance out of your existing network infrastructure is becoming more and more important. So we want to ensure that, you know, networking is not considered the bottleneck. So, you know, you don't hear reasons like, you know, this is all that I could transfer. You know, I'm not able to hit line rate because Windows Server wouldn't let me do it. I have a 10 gig network, a NIC connected, but Windows is capping out of the CPU because it's not able to transfer 10 gigs of data across. So we want to ensure that networking is no longer the bottleneck with respect to Windows Server. We want to make sure that no matter what hardware you use, if you have industry standard NICs, you still get the best performance that could be extracted out of those NICs. We want to make sure that you get predictable performance. It's not just the best performance, but it's also predictable. And finally, the ability to scale automatically as demand increases, right? So the technologies that help with that are VRSS, which is new in Windows Server 2012 R2, SRIOE, which we introduced in 2012, Dynamic Virtual Machine Queue, new in 2012, and SMB Direct, which was introduced in 2012, but we've enhanced in R2. So SMB Direct, or RDMA, is the ability to offload data transfer onto your intelligent NICs. So most 10 gig NICs these days are intelligent enough where, you know, you could actually offload the data transfer onto the NIC and the NICs would do the transfer. I mean, think of a non-RDMA scenario, right? Let's say that a client wants to do the transfer onto the server, right? There is a large file copy. So the application sends the data, it goes through the SMB client, goes through the TCP/IP layer, onto the NIC driver, onto the NIC of the receiver, again goes through the same path, right? Goes through the NIC driver, goes through the TCP/IP stack, and then finally onto the server operating system and then to the storage. And every time, you know, so as it goes through this stack, this step essentially takes CPU resources. So the example that I spoke about where, you know, if you have a 10 gig NIC and you're transferring large amount of data, if all three layers take CPU resources, you're essentially, you know, bottlenecked on CPU. So how much data you could transfer essentially depends on how much CPU ability that you have. So if you have a shared infrastructure with a mission-critical workload that's virtualized and running, you want to make sure that your CPU is actually dedicated for your workloads and not just the data transfer, right? With RDMA, what you're essentially doing is bypassing most of this layer, where you're telling the NIC that, hey, NIC, this is the amount of data that I want to transfer. This is where the data starts. Go to the transfer and let me know once the transfer is done. And the NIC automatically does the transfer and lets the client know once the transfer is completed. So this helps achieve line rate with 10 gigs and to a large extent with 40 gig NICs as well. This is irrespective of what kind of reads writes that you see, right? Even as small as 8K reads and writes can still get great performance. And that's the area that we focused a lot with respect to R2. In 2012, if they are large data sizes, then the performance was phenomenal. But for small data sizes, the performance wasn't that great, and we basically brought 8K chunks to line rate as well, which is huge. Dynamic virtual machine queue, again, like I said, this was introduced in 2012. Again, effectively use the host resources so that the host is no longer the bottleneck. So without VM queue, all the incoming traffic is typically passed to the first CPU that exists, and then the CPU decides how the traffic is going to be distributed, right? So if the CPU is pegged, if it's bottlenecked, the traffic is basically waiting, right, for the CPU to free up. So we introduce something called VM queue. So the VM queue basically creates a queue, and the traffic is distributed across multiple CPUs that you may have, right? So what happens is that, you know, this is good that it uses all the available resources, but it's not intelligent enough to understand the load on each of the CPU. And that's where dynamic VM queue comes into the picture. So the processor cores are dynamically allocated and spread across depending on the traffic that each of the core is seeing. So for example, you know, in this specific example, it first sends it to CPU 0, and then it realizes that, you know what, hey, CPU 1 is busy, CPU 0 is already busy, but CPU 2 is free. Let me just send it to that. And any incoming traffic is not sent to CPU 2 from that point on till it frees up, and then it's dynamically routed onto CPU 1 or CPU 0. So it basically maintains a queue and then dynamically routes the queue to different CPU, different procs that you have in your multi-proc machine. Again, helps with respect to network transfer rates. Virtual RSS, so this was built on RSS that we spoke about earlier. So just a quick refresh on RSS. It's very similar to what we saw on the previous slide. So if you have a multi-node machine, all the traffic on a multi-node machine without RSS goes to the first node and multiple procs within that, right? So if you have multiple nodes, even though the other nodes are free, it's all going to the first node. But with RSS, we are evenly distributing the traffic across multiple NUMA-aware nodes so that all the nodes are equally used. So again, you're not pegged on how much CPU resource that you have within a specific node. But the challenge here is that, you know, when it goes into the virtual machine world, right, the same problem continues to persist. All the incoming traffic goes to the first virtual proc within the VM. So even though the other virtual procs are free, how much you can transfer will be dependent on how much how pegged the first vproc is. So with VRSS, we are essentially taking RSS into the virtual world. So the incoming traffic is now split across multiple virtual procs, and this again helps you hit line rate. So like I said, on 10 gig, on 40 gig, and even on 100 gig, it lets you transfer more data and lets you use the resources more effectively. It doesn't require any hardware upgrade, controllable using PowerShell, pretty straightforward to set up. The next topic that I want to talk about was SRIOV. Again, nothing new in terms of R2, but something important, something that we did in 2012, where, you know, we completely bypass the Hyper-V switch, the Hyper-V extensible switch, and all the packets are directly routed onto the virtual machine. So for example, the traffic between the VM and the NIC typically goes through the Hyper-V switch. Whenever it goes through the Hyper-V switch, there are policies that are enforced. There are forwarding happens, filtering happens, and so on. And all these things take CPU resources, right? You might have certain kind of workloads that really does not require any kind of intervention from the Hyper-V switch. Think of the storage traffic, right, where you just want the storage traffic to directly go into the VM. So some of the NICs are intelligent and they support SRIO, which is single root IO virtualization, and they provide virtual functions for the VM to directly talk to these virtual functions that exist within the NIC. So it completely bypasses the virtual switch, and the data transfer happens between the VM and the physical NIC directly. Again, an important point to realize is if the VM has traffic where it needs to go through either security or packet forwarding, packet filtering policies where you want to enforce some level of security, this is not the solution that you want. But if there is traffic where you want to get that performance, like I mentioned, the storage traffic, this is an ideal solution. And one thing to remember with SRIOV that's different with 2012 is that even when you live migrate the VM, the SRIOV properties are carried over. So SRIOV is not disabled when you live migrate a VM, and that's something new. In terms of operational efficiency, right, the next thing that I want to talk about is how we've simplified management of networking with work that we've done both in Windows Server 2012 R2 and in System Center Virtual Machine Manager and Operations Manager. So whether you're dealing at it at host level or at cloud level using System Center, there is a lot of stuff that we've done in terms of simplifying manageability. So we wanted to provide an easy to use robust automation framework, which is essentially PowerShell, right? Whatever you are able to do with the UI, you should be able to do it with PowerShell. Whatever you're able to do it with PowerShell, you should be able to automate it from within our System Center Orchestrator and do it from within Virtual Machine Manager, right? So just give that end-to-end automation capability. We want to make sure that, you know, in addition to the traditional infrastructure services that we've been providing with, for example, DNS or DHCP servers, we also wanted to give a solution to manage the IP address infrastructure. We wanted to simplify management in multi-site environments. And finally, ability to monitor resource usage, right? In a shared infrastructure, especially for service providers, they want to understand how much resources or what resources each of their tenants used. So ability to, you know, monitor and meter different capabilities. And the technologies that cover those aspects are IP address management, resource metering, operations manager, network monitoring with operations manager, network management and provisioning with System Center Virtual Machine Manager and Windows PowerShell. Like I mentioned, IP address management is now part of Windows Server 2012, and it's been enhanced tremendously with R2. So you could essentially import information from your DNS and DHCP servers. You could add DNS and DHCP servers to Windows Server 2012 IPAM solution, and it automatically integrates all the IP address information. So you could then create IP address spaces and then assign it to multiple hosts or group them together, have different user privileges depending on what you want to do, all from within the IPAM context. And the IPAM is an add-in to Server Manager. So you could do complete IP address management from within Windows Server 2012 now. It also has rich reporting capabilities. So you could, for auditing purposes, you could find out what IP address is a specific VM or a specific physical host took, or the changes that it went through, or, you know, find machines within a specific IP address range and what those machines are, what operating systems they are running, and so on, right? So deep auditing capability. You could understand the IP address allocation depending on dates that you provide, and so on. And because it integrates with DNS and DHCP server, it automatically updates information based on what the server provides it. With respect to R2, there are a few important changes that we've done. The first and foremost is that in addition to managing the physical IP address space, it also manages the virtualized address space. So things like network virtualization and the IP address range of the IP address pools that you create from within VM networks, all those things could be managed in addition to the physical IP address. So the host addresses, the customer addresses, all those could be managed from within IPAM. The other thing that it does is the reporting, the database that IPAM used in 2012 was the inbuilt SQL database that ships with Windows Server. But with R2, you could actually point an external SQL database as the database for IPAM. And that gives you the ability to build rich reporting on top of what IPAM already provides you. And SQL could be configured for high availability, so IPAM could now be highly available as a result of that. So Windows Server could be clustered together, and at the back end, you have SQL, which shows that, you know, IPAM is really ready for enterprise scale. And that could be configured for high availability as well. The other thing that we've done is, you know, you have different user roles and user scopes depending on what you want to do. You have the traditional admins who could define IP address ranges, add DNS, DHCP servers, make changes to them. You have just consumers of the information that you already created. So you have IPAM admins, you have server admins, you have network admins, you have users who can view and perform different actions depending on what they're allowed to do. PowerShell, again, enhanced with R2, we have over 400 PowerShell commandlets just for networking alone. So anything and everything that you could do within a UI could be automated using PowerShell. And we also spoke about OMI, where, you know, in addition to managing using WMI to manage Windows, you could use something like OMI to manage top-of-rack switches from Arista, for example, and you could use PowerShell to configure them. So you could set properties, get properties from PowerShell, talk through OMI onto your physical devices. Resource metering, this was introduced with Windows Server 2012. You have rich PowerShell ability to monitor resource usage, be it, you know, average CPU time per VM, per group of VMs. So you could group a bunch of VMs together that constitute a single app and identify what kind of storage it's using, how much memory it's using, how much CPU it's using, what kind of network it's using, and then either do show back or bill back after that, right? Again, configurable through PowerShell, rich in functionality. A lot of service providers and, you know, large-scale enterprises just love this feature. So, like I mentioned, you know, you have the ability to monitor and meter multiple tenants at the same time and define rules around it. Remote live monitoring. So this is another fantastic tool that was that's introduced with 2012 R2. So this gives you the ability to monitor traffic on a host remotely. So you could get near lifetime traffic monitoring experience on a remote host and monitor the traffic that goes from VM to another VM or from VM to another host all remotely. So it provides, it integrates tightly with Message Analyzer, which is the NetMon tool that a lot of you have used in the past, an ability to collect the traffic and then run reports using it, right? You could deep dive and understand what kind of data was transferred. You could perform additional monitoring in that. You could capture ETW events if you want to. You could set specific triggers and then enforce it on a remote machine and ask it to capture specific packets if the triggers are alerted and so on. So this is something that a lot of admins have been asking for. Physical traffic, you've had tools in the past, but virtual traffic, VM to VM traffic, network remote live monitoring lets you do it. So we spoke about this in the previous section around how System Center Virtual Machine Manager is not only a management tool for VMs, but it also helps you manage your networking and your storage resources as well, right? So VMM kind of helps you abstract resources, be it, you know, your switches and your routers, your compute, or your storage, and then expose it to multiple clouds or multiple people and provide a self-service experience by pooling these resources together. So like I said, logical networks, think of them as a logical abstraction of the underlying physical infrastructure, right? So this basically accumulates all the physical infrastructure that you have and then projects it onto your virtual world. Once you have that, then you could create multiple VM networks depending on what different tenants want. So you could have a VM network for Coke, you could have a VM network for Pepsi, and so on, and you know, get that isolation that you want. And these VM networks gives you that isolation and flexibility and the ability to port VMs from one host onto another host without having to change the network configuration information. A quick run through here: System Center Virtual Machine Manager lets you manage your load balancers. So a lot of load balancers that are available in market today have plugins to System Center Virtual Machine Manager. You can manage them from within a single console, assign it to different private clouds that you may already have, different host groups or different networks, all from within System Center Virtual Machine Manager. We spoke about switch extensions. We have switch extensions from Cisco, NEC, NMON, Five9, and others. And System Center Virtual Machine Manager acts as a centralized management tool for managing multiple switch extensions. So you could create these logical switches and apply these switch extensions to these logical switches, and then push these logical switches onto multiple hosts that you may have. And it provides the self-service experience to both, you know, add a switch extension to Virtual Machine Manager and push that switch extension onto a host that you want. And finally, you could manage both the inbox Hyper-V network virtualization gateway, the site-to-site multi-tenant gateway that helps you bridge the virtual world with the physical world, and also third-party gateways from within Virtual Machine Manager. So like I said, ability to create user-defined VM networks or network overlays and also manage traditional networking infrastructure all from within Virtual Machine Manager. So in terms of examples, like I said, F5's Big IP could be managed from within System Center Virtual Machine Manager. The Microsoft Network Load Balancer could be managed. We spoke about the switch extensions. We spoke about different partners who provide gateways like IN Networks, FY, Huawei, and so on. The next topic that I wanted to talk about is System Center Operations Manager. So System Center Operations Manager, for people who wouldn't know, also has inbuilt network monitoring. So you have the ability to not only monitor virtual machines and physical hosts, but you also get a rich view of the network devices that the host is connected to. So it gives you a rich layout and gives you the ability to dive deeper into each of the ports and interfaces and understand the traffic that goes through it. Find out how much traffic went past a specific port, what kind of bandwidth it was trying to hit, where the traffic originated from, and so on, right? So it basically increases visibility into your underlying physical network infrastructure. The example that I would like to say is, you know, if a specific VM is not performing well, more often than not, the server admin typically looks into the VM and just tries to see if it all works fine, and then looks to see if the host is configured correct. And as long as that works, the blame or, you know, the investigation is passed on to the networking guys after that. Because the server admins more often than not do not have visibility into what happens after the packet leaves the physical host. But with System Center Operations Manager, it provides a rich view of how the data flows through the network. For example, in this case, the data from the host is connected to a from the VM is connected to a specific host, and then it passes on to a specific networking device before it goes to another host. And gives the status of each of these intermediate hops so that, you know, when there is an issue, you know visually as to where the issue is running. So if one of the hosts in between or one of the network devices in between is not working, it automatically flags you. And it uses SNMP protocol to basically query these network devices and understand the status. So it's and most network devices support SNMP and respond to SNMP. And how much information System Center Operations Manager displays, depending on how much information the network device gives through SNMP. So essentially in this screen, you see, you know, where the issue is, right? So you could actually dive deep into the VM, the app, basically start with the app, dive, double click into the VM, into the host, and into the network devices and see where the issue is actually running. And you also have the ability to see how well each of these interfaces are performing. So this all, in addition to understanding and fixing the problems, it also lets you proactively manage where a potential problem could arise, right? For example, if you have a specific port that's running at 99%, you know that, you know what, something is not running right or something is not configured right, and you need to do something about it soon. So the last piece that I want to talk about is, you know, networking in the hybrid cloud world. So what we essentially wanted to do was seamlessly extend the data center onto Azure. Most customers are looking at, you know, Azure or service provider as a logical extension to their own data center. And we wanted to provide the ability to for customers to easily extend their data center onto Azure. We want to provide an inbox gateway to extend beyond the private cloud. We spoke about this in the previous section, and I'll talk about it again. And the technologies that we have here are around, you know, cross-premises connectivity, around ability to extend the data center either onto Azure or onto the service provider's data center. So hybrid networking in Windows Server 2012, like we spoke about, we had, you know, a site-to-site VPN as a part of remote access server, right? So this let, it basically let remote users connect into corporate resources in a secure fashion. But the challenge was that it needed one VM per tenant for the gateway, right? It wasn't multi-tenant, the gateway wasn't multi-tenant. And to a large extent, it requires, you know, network virtualization. So with R2, we basically have a multi-tenant gateway, which means that for every 100 tenants, you could actually configure a highly available gateway that could do site-to-site NAT and forwarding between two data centers and to remote sites as well. So what you could essentially have is, you know, roaming workers. You could have apps that lie in a specific data center that send or that access resources in either the customer's data center or a host's data center and use the site-to-site gateway to essentially communicate across the two. So the gateway uses BGP for dynamic route updates. So again, it's an industry standard protocol, and it provides, you know, multi-tenant aware NAT for internet access. So when the traffic goes out, it could go out with an IP address that you configure it to have. So essentially what you need to have is a site-to-site gateway that connects your or customer's data center with the service provider's data center. And we spoke about this briefly where the gateway can be configured for high availability. So what that essentially means is that you could cluster the gateway together. So the gateway is essentially a VM. So you could cluster a couple of VMs together so that it's in active standby mode, so that even if one gateway VM goes down, the other VM automatically takes over. So connecting to the Azure, I just want to extend on what we spoke in the previous slide and then talk about what's now possible in the new world, right? So with the gateway, you could essentially create virtual networks in Azure and have virtual networks in your own data center, both having the same IP address range, and for a gateway to be in between and forward packets back and forth. So you could, for example, have the database tier on your own data center or on the customer's data center, so that the data is safe and secure in the customer's data center. And you could have the web front end in Azure that could seamlessly extend, that could seamlessly scale depending on properties that you set, and for the gateway to be the intermediate translator between these two worlds. And you could securely transfer data back and forth. So it opens up a whole wide variety of opportunities in a multi-cloud world, having the ability to connect two different data centers. So like I said in the previous screen, so this need not be just customer's data center talking to Azure. It could be individual computers that are behind a firewall or remote workers accessing secure information. So all of that could actually go through the gateway now. So in, I just wanted to summarize what we spoke about in this section. So we briefly spoke about advancing software-defined networking, everything that we've done in the world of SDN. And then we spoke about, you know, how we are delivering continuous availability in the networking world with a wide variety of features, everything that we are doing to improve network performance significantly, both at the virtual layer and at the physical layer. Finally, we spoke about, you know, management capabilities that exist within Windows Server 2012 and System Center to centrally manage your VMs, hosts across your entire data center. And finally, we spoke about how we could seamlessly integrate the public cloud or service provider's cloud with customer's data center. So all of this is available with Windows Server 2012 and Windows Server 2012 R2 and manageable using System Center 2012 R2. Get started, the eval versions or the trial versions of Windows Server and System Center are available for download. You could download it and use it for about 180 days. Rich functionalities like network virtualization is now available from within Windows Server and System Center, so you don't need a separate third-party suite or an additional layer of software to try out these rich capabilities. There is a certification process that's available in microsoft.com/learning. Go through it, and this video, and there are several other videos in microsoftvirtualacademy.com for you to understand investments that we've made, not only in Windows Server 2012 in networking, but across virtualization storage, across individual components in System Center for you to understand more. Thank you very much. I hope you found this session useful. Thank you again.